Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Lord our God, you are worthy of all our praise. You are the God who never fails to keep his promises. We thank you that in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, we see your love, justice, mercy, provision, and victory. You are the God who lifts up those who are weighed down. You are the God who provides for your children. Our desire, Lord, is to praise you as long as we live, to inhabit our praises as we gather every day. O Lord, our good shepherd, you are the source of all true and lasting joy. We praise you for your power, which is beyond compare. We worship you for your wisdom, which is beyond understanding. You can meet all our needs. You restore the brokenhearted and heal the wounded. You have revealed yourself to your people and are building your church against which the gates of hell cannot prevail. How great are you, Lord? Fill our hearts with love as we respond by singing praises to you. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the bread of life. Let us feast on you and find nourishment for our souls. You are the light of the world, and let us follow you out of the darkness. You are the door. Let us enter the Father's presence in your name. You are the good shepherd. Let us rest in your provision. You are the resurrection and the life. Let us find true life and victory in you. You are the way, the truth, and the life. Let us love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Eternal God, you are our rock. You are the firm foundation for everything we build. You give gifts to your people for the good of the church. You equip and train your people to carry out the good works you have prepared for us in advance. We ask you, Lord, that you would provide wisdom, guidance, and direction in our lives. Remind us that you are our loving ally. You are our fortress. You are our tower of strength, and you are our rescuer. Everything we need, Lord, is found in you. Faithful Father, we begin today by giving you thanks. Your love endures forever. It never fails. Though there are many ways in which we have failed, we have not exceeded the supply of your mercy and grace. And so we thank you for revealing yourself to us through your word. So that as we open the scriptures every day, we pray that we would hear your voice. We ask that your Holy Spirit will be at work, opening our ears to hear and our hearts to receive your word. May we be transformed into your likeness. All these things we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed will be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, but lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory
reading is taken from Acts chapter 2, verse 42 to 47. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. All came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. The word of the Lord.
One, two.
Brothers and sisters in Christ. The devotion which I'm about to share with you this evening is entitled Signs of a Healthy Church. Let us pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we wait to hear from you. So we ask you to open our ears, open our hearts, and open our minds so that we can receive your word openly. We ask you, Lord, that as we hear your word and as we reflect on your word, that we would be able to apply it as we traverse several spaces. And so let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Signs of a healthy church. My friends, how would you describe a healthy church? Can you discern biblical signs of a healthy church? And remember, the church is people, not a building, not the clergy, and not people that hit a certain watermark of spirituality. It is everyone who has been united to Christ by faith. On the day of Pentecost, Peter's sermon, 3,000 saved, and right away the church begins to form. And we begin to see some of the characteristics of this church. We see the ethos of it, the culture. So what were these people about? This new community brought into existence through the resurrection of Jesus Christ and indwelt by the Spirit. And so let us focus on a few signs of a healthy church. You might say this is what it looks like when the Holy Spirit comes to church. The first sign, devotion to the Word. My friends, it is no surprise that this is mentioned first. The apostles' teaching or doctrine. The Spirit had been poured out and was doing amazing things, but they were devoted to doctrine. It is not incidental the church's commitment to the Word is the first point mentioned. This was central. The Spirit had been poured out and was working dynamically, but they did not jettison the Scriptures. When the apostles preached Christ in Jerusalem and beyond, how did they do this? They proved from the Old Testament that Jesus was the Son of God. Paul's custom was often to start in the synagogue and preach Christ from the Old Testament. The Bereans were more noble. I would, however, suggest that we actually have an advantage to the early church in that we have the full canon of Scriptures. Sound, healthy doctrine is essential to the spiritual health of a church. Without it, a church is like a garden without protective fence around the vegetables, which are then eaten up by all the critters at night. The early church continually devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. And a healthy church, my friends, will be devoted to good, sound doctrine. It will be devoted to the Word of God, the Scriptures. The second sign, continual devotion to one another. They devoted themselves to the fellowship. Fellowship, also known as koinonia, which means to share in common. In this context, to share life in common, sharing life together. Put simply, they were devoted to each other. In verse 44, it says, "And all who believed had all things in common." Notice it was not a general solidarity with all of mankind, but a particular fellowship among those who believed. Of course, we are to love and care for all, but as Paul says, especially those who are of the household of faith. And we read this in Galatians chapter 6, verse 10. We must be ready to allow ourselves to be interrupted by God, my friends. God will be constantly crossing our paths and canceling our plans by sending us people with claims and petitions. The one another passages in the New Testament highlight how important this real devotion to family of faith is. Here is a sampling of these. Love one another as I have loved you. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Bear one another's burdens. Forgive one another. Confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. Be hospitable to one another. Clothe yourselves with humility toward another. This is clearly not for the casual Sunday Christian, my friends. It's a challenge because it imposes. But how dynamic when it is a church when it is devoted to each other in this way? Nobody without serious friendships. A healthy church is devoted to one another. The third sign, continual devotion to the breaking of bread. And we read this in verse 42. They continually devoted themselves to the breaking of bread. This undoubtedly refers to the Lord's Supper. The early church was committed to keeping this ordinance that the Lord Jesus gave them. Therefore, the church was devoted to hearing the word of the gospel preached or taught, reading the scriptures, and also what the Puritan Thomas Watson called visible sermon of the Lord's Supper, which is a mirror in which to gaze on the sufferings and death of Christ. The cross, though a scandal to the unbelieving world, was at the center of the worship of the early days. This speaks to the Christ-centered nature of this newly formed church, as they were continually devoted to the breaking of bread. The fourth sign, continual devotion to prayer. My friends, throughout Acts, we see the church's vibrant prayer life. They prayed in the temple, in homes, and in prison. They prayed in private and public. They prayed together and on their own. They prayed when they encountered the sick and crippled, and when they were faced with intense persecution. They prayed for the release of Peter from prison, and prayers launched the first missionary movement. In other words, prayer was the fuel for everything they did, and so they prayed without ceasing. And why were they so committed to prayer? I can imagine the disciples remember well the enormous promises Jesus had given to them the night before he was crucified. Words like, this early church with few resources and seemingly insurmountable obstacles shook the world, and largely because they prayed. Brothers and sisters, a healthy church is a praying church. And so we should encourage each other to engage in daily prayer, to make sure that we meet corporately for prayer, that we do our devotions every day, that we do our breath prayers. Sign five, spiritual power. If a church is devoted to prayer, what would you expect to happen? God's power. Let us refer to verse 43. A healthy church experiences God powerfully working among them. This is not marginal in the book of Acts. The next chapter, Acts chapter 3, we see the first miracle when Peter and John are used to raise a grown man who was lame from birth. In chapter 4, after being released from custody and warned not to speak about Jesus, remember how they prayed? They prayed that miraculous works be done. They asked for boldness to continue to speak about Jesus. And there were others, non-apostles. God granted this supernatural power too. Acts chapter 6 verse 8 says, and Stephen, full of grace and power, was doing great wonders and signs among the people. Stephen was an apostle. He was chosen to wait on tables. Another man chosen to wait on tables was Philip, who spread out to Samaria when persecution became hot in Jerusalem. Later in the books of Acts, we see Paul, whose handkerchiefs were taken to those afflicted and they were healed. In the final chapter of Acts, Paul is used to heal everyone on the island of Malta. The history of the church is full of stories of God continuing to work in, among, and through his people like this. Brothers and sisters, in our modern day, with all of our technological advances, we have a challenging time thinking in this way, and we cannot make this happen. We definitely can't demand that God do certain things, but we can seek him and his power, like in Acts chapter 4, in order that he might be glorified among us and his people may be blessed. And we can be open to how he may want to work among us. Is it possible that God could surprise us with what he is not only able to do, but willing to do if we seek him and his power? So my friends, I implore all of us to to continue to seek God's power. And the only way we can do this is to open our hearts and open ourselves to the Holy Spirit. The sixth sign, radical generosity. And we read this in verses 44 and 45. The outworking of doing life together was a kind of generosity that I think makes us a little uncomfortable. The Bible does not advocate communism, taking people's things by force, but it does advocate and even command generosity, a glad, uncoerced generosity. This is New Testament fellowship, sharing life together. And notice, it was generosity with a purpose. The church was sensitive to the needs of those among them. My friends, are we sensitive to the needs of those people around us? Those people who are sitting right next to us in the pews? Are we sensitive to them? Do we recognize when their spirit changes, when their facial expressions change, that something might be happening with them? Are we sensitive to the needs in the communities next door? Not one person went to be hungry or slept in the streets, my friends. Remember, a healthy church exercises radical generosity. And I believe that it begins internally within the body of Christ. The seventh sign, daily togetherness. The church lived out the one another in life day by day. The one another in life day by day. They met together on several occasions. They were involved in each other's lives constantly. Large and small gatherings. In Hebrews chapter 3 verse 13 it reads, encourage one another every day as long as it is called today. How long will it be called today, my friends? As long as you are alive. But there's a saying that half the job of a good church member is showing up. You cannot build relationships if you aren't meeting with God's people. And we hear people say, but we don't have to go into the church. We can fellowship otherwise. But remember, we need to show up so that we can build relationships. We cannot build relationships if we are not in the physical church or the virtual space. In a healthy church, there is regular interaction. And we have this regular interaction through our various groups, in our various spaces. Class meeting, women's commission, women's league, men's fellowship, youth group. Remember, regular interaction is critical for a healthy church. The eighth sign, reverent, glad and lively worship. Let us be honest. These three adjectives don't seem to all go together. Glad and lively, probably. Not reverent, though. But it was all three. Notice verse 43. All came upon every soul. The word translated all is phobos, where we get our term phobia, for example. Verse 46 says, they had glad hearts. The word glad means extreme joy. These people had little to be happy about circumstantially. Verse 47 says they were praising God. Praise is a verb and it appears to always include verbal praise. So not just quiet personal praise, but outward exuberant praise. It speaks of a lively praise. It's used in Acts chapter 3 verse 8 to 9. After a lame man is healed, and it says he was walking and leaping and praising God. The final sign, my friends, displays of an attractive faith to outsiders. And we read this in verse 47a. Having favor with all people. I think it had to have been the beauty of the human relationships. Francis Schaeffer said, and I quote, true Christianity produces beauty as well as truth. If we do not show beauty in the way we treat each other, then in the eyes of the world and in the eyes of our own children, we are destroying the truth we proclaim. My friends, they were committed to truth, but they were also committed to the practical, real-life implications of what they believed. And so as we traverse the book of Acts, it will become evident that not everyone will find the Christian community attractive. But to many non-Christians, it should look strangely attractive. Brothers and sisters, this is the kind of church that makes the real Jesus known and non-ignorable. And so I implore all of us to strive with all God's help to grow in these qualities. By seeking the Lord and his outpouring, through obedience to what we know, and finally, continually being sensitive and responsive to the Lord. Amen.
On Christ alone, our chief cornerstone, no other foundation can we build upon. Not philosophy, nor the wisdom of man, all other ground is sinking sand. Upon this rock you build your church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. When we bind and loose, we proclaim your truth, and in Jesus' name we will not fail.
Raised up from the dead, let captivity captive, it is finished. Oh, he gave us the keys, his authority. Now we are joined.
Build your church, build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. It's your church, build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. We are your church, build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. Please, oh, build your church, oh, build your church, build it from the ground up.
greater than us. Oh, 'cause it's bigger than us.
Let us pray. King of glory, we thank you for revealing your love to us today in a powerful way. As we depart this devotion space, may your grace and love be with us each and every day. Bless us, O Lord, with your unfading love and cause the work of our hands to prosper. Uphold us in the palm of your hand and see us through each stage of our lives as we reflect on the healthy signs, on the signs of a healthy church. Let the peace that surpasses all understanding be with us as we leave this virtual space. Help us, Lord, to make a difference in the world every day. Allow our words and actions to align with your word, Lord. Help us to practice what we have learned here this evening. Help us to be a blessing to everyone that we meet and interact with. Help us never to forget that you are always with us. In Jesus' name, we believe and pray. Amen.
For being a part of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to His word and may it dwell in all of us richly.